Hello, happy July 5th, everyone. I am Brian. You are Chords and Notes Nation. These are my two unnamed trolls, and this is another music reaction. This is going to be a Rush reaction to the song Beneath, Between, and Behind. This is going to further the discussion I started with the Iced Earth song 1776, sort of a political commentary on the United States, where we're at, where we've been, that sort of thing. A couple of things I want to cover. First of all, if there's a lag on this video, between the video and audio, I apologize. I'm working to solve it. I'm using an Android as my camera, and sometimes a lot lately it's been doing this, so I've been working on cleaning out storage space and all the different types of things to kind of tweak it to make sure I don't have these issues, but it appears that I continue to do have them. So what's likely going to happen is I'm probably going to open a Patreon page sooner than later in order to fund some new equipment, because my equipment is rather old. However, like I've sold in every video, this is raw, unedited, and honest. So you get what you get. You're going to get noise. You're going to get all these things. I hope you can stick with me here. I hope you guys are well, and I hope you had a great 4th. Let's go. Beneath, between, and behind. Song. Used to know how to play it, or I'll probably freshen up at some point and do a play along and put it on my channel for you guys. Okay, so let's get right into it, because I think it's rather important. It is a very significant song. especially when we want to do a commentary, like I am doing, on my political thoughts, what's going on in with the United States. But just to give it a backdrop, this was written and recorded in 1975. This is when Neil Peart joined the band. For those of you who are unfamiliar with Rush, he joined the band as the drummer and lyricist, and pretty much wrote every single song from 75 onwards for 40 years. So, a very thoughtful person. And back in that time, very much an objectivist, heavily influenced by Ayn Rand. And I would say his political leanings were more libertarian than anything. And especially that was pretty much when the Libertarian Party came, was the advent of it. I think was 1972, 1973, thereabouts. So you probably couldn't hear the lyrics very well, because the way Geddy Lee sings, especially in the earlier years. But I'll read along and give you my thoughts. 10 score years ago, defeat the kingly foe. Okay, score is 20 years. 10 score. Okay, 200 years ago. So right around 1975, 76, this is when it was written. So 1775, 1776, when the revolution started. A wondrous dream came into being, and it really was. Like I've commented, the United States was the grand experiment of the Enlightenment idealism, and this shift in power from the autocrats to the people. But the shift was based upon human rights. They're basic rights that we were born with, that, you know, they can't be given, they can't be taken away. Tame the trackless waste, no virgin land left chaste. So that's kind of alluding to the Louisiana Purchase and Lewis and Clark, and let's tame this entire wild continent. All shining eyes, but never seeing. So the whole, you know, you got something in your eye, the shining eyes, a goal, something to go after, but you're not seeing what you're doing. You're missing out on what's going on. So then the chorus is, beneath the noble bird, the eagle, between the proudest words, the Declaration of Independence, behind the beauty, cracks appear. That could be a twofer. You know, it behind the beauty that is the United States, or that the advent of the United States, there are cracks. But that could also be the Liberty Bell, a reference to the Liberty Bell as well. Once with heads held high, they sang out to the sky, why do their shadows bow in fear? Next verse. Watch the cities rise. So now we're building up as a nation. Another ship arrives. Earth's melting pot and ever growing. So a lot of immigration going on here. Fantastic dreams come true, inventing something new. The greatest minds were never knowing. Yeah. And then the final. The guns replace the plow. Facades are tarnished now. I'm going to stop there. So especially then, in the 70s, you had a lot of cultural and issues going on. You had a lot of world issues going on. Vietnam was just ending. We had just been in a series of war, World War I, World War II, Korean War, Vietnam War. It just seems like now the guns have replaced the plow. You know, we're now a warring nation rather than a growing nation. Facades are tarnished now, so all the things that symbolized who we are, who we were, there's a tarnish on it. The principles have been betrayed. That's a matter of opinion. The dream's gone stale, but still let hope prevail. History's debt won't be repaid. Well, what is history's debt? You know, it's often been said that if you don't learn from history, you're doomed to repeat it. So is that your debt to history? I suppose it's, in a way, it can be true, but you're not really repeating history. You're just going to make the same mistakes over and over. And I think that's where he's going with this is, you know, now who's going to become the tyrant? And we're kind of dealing with that still today, all these years later. We have a lot of power play going on. And I'm not going to say one way or another, but as objectively as I can, I think there certainly are forces out there that over the years, over the decades, have been trying to subvert the United States, the dream, that is, and trying to weaken her and bring her down. And that's from within as well as from without. And there are those who are standing up against that, and you know, oftentimes those people are demonized, and unfairly so, because honestly, understanding history, understanding the principles which this country was founded on, nothing's perfect when you're dealing with humanity. Okay, I'm not saying this nation's perfect, and it should be you know. We should be shamed into submission, because there's a lot of people out there that are trying to shame us for everything. Okay? We learn and we grow. You don't do that to your own children. You don't shame your children, because then what happens to them? You steal their power, you steal their confidence, you steal who they are, and you don't allow them to grow. Humanity is full of mistakes, from the individual to the society, the greater society. The real thing that should be considered is, are we learning from it? And certainly erasing the history because there were bad things is not the way to go. Because think about this. Imagine you live in a world where all of the history has been erased, and the only history that you're allowed to know is the stuff that you're allowed to know. Now you've become that which you fought against. You have to stare those things in the face. The bad things that you've done as a nation, in order not to have history's debt repaid. So to tear everything down, to erase everything, to make it all go away because it's offensive is not right. It's not. It is a form of societal totalitarianism, and you have to look at the things that you've done as a nation. I mean, I wasn't around for any of those things, so I don't feel a personal shame over it. I mean, my ancestors didn't migrate here until the early 1900s, so we never really did take part in institutionalism of slavery and all of the things that went on. But yet there's forces out there that would say just because of our skin color that we're guilty by association. Really? I've got a lot of friends of a lot of different skin colors, and I could care less what color their skin is. You know, I'm more interested in the quality of the human being, their soul, their heart. I don't care what their skin color is. My skin color changes. I stay out in the sun long enough, I get a little bit darker. I mean, what does that mean? It means nothing. Skin color means nothing. That's ridiculous. And a lot of times you have people who are saying they're champions of this cause and that cause that they're not being champions of anything. They are what they're saying they're fighting against. It's true. But, you know, I really love this song. Really love the lyrics. It's Rush. What can I say? It's early Rush. So complexity, it wasn't very complex as far as time changes, key changes, composition, that sort of thing. But it was full. It had full sound. Alex using a lot of the fuller chords really brings out a lot of sound and makes it sound like a bigger band than just a three-piece. Anyways, that's all I have for this one. I hope you guys are well. Please hang in there when it comes to the technical difficulties here. I will try and sort through. And be well. Stay well, and I will talk to you soon.